Tamil Nadu is bustling with election activity. The state is set to vote in the first phase of the Lok Sabha polls on April 19th. What is the battle scene like? Vanakkam. This is T. Suresh Kumar. Thank you for joining me in this episode of the Hindu Focus Tamil Nadu. The battle lines are clearly drawn in Tamil Nadu, which has 39 Lok Sabha constituencies, and Puducherry, which has just one seat. So who are the key players? Essentially, it's a four-quadrant contest. On the one hand, you have the DMK-led India bloc, then you have the AIADMK's alliance and the BJP's colourful alliance, I would say. And along with that, you have the Naam Tamilar Kaatchi of film director Seeman that will be contesting all alone in the 40 constituencies. Well, there are these four players. The Naam Tamilar Kaatchi has organically grown over the years, and it's fielding 20 women and 20 male in the constituencies in Tamil Nadu and Puducherry. But from the ground situation, it appears that the party would at best be able to play spoilsport, gathering or perhaps improving its own share, but nowhere close to challenging the main contenders. So essentially, this Lok Sabha polls will be a big battle between the DMK-led India bloc, the AIADMK alliance and the BJP alliance. Let's take a look at each of these formations. The DMK-led alliance is way ahead of the others. Stalin, the president of the DMK and chief minister of Tamil Nadu, has completed the seat sharing exercise with all the allies. It's more or less on the lines of 2019, where the DMK gets to contest 21 seats. The Congress will contest in 10 seats, including the one seat in Puducherry. The left parties, two left parties, and the VCK get two each. The MDMK gets one, the IUML gets one in Ramanathapuram. The KMDMK gets the Namakkal constituency, where it will field a candidate on the DMK symbol. So that's the scene with the DMK front. In fact, the party has gone ahead and released the list of its candidates as well. One difference this time is VCK's Ravi Kumar, as well as the MDMK candidate Durai Vago in Tiruchi, will be contesting on their own respective symbols than on the rising sun symbol, as these parties did in the past. Some of the key players in this formation will be the Vidudalai Chirutegal Kachi's founder Thol Thirumavalavan and writer Ravi Kumar, who will be testing waters again from Villapuram. Thirumavalavan is entering the fray in Chidambaram. Both of these are reserved constituencies. The CPI, CPIM, KMDK and IUML have also announced the candidates. The CPM has renominated Sahitya Academy winner Sue Venkateshan from Madurai. The DMK has also released its list, and 10 of the sitting MPs have been retained. The rest are fresh faces. Among the notable contestants who have been retained are the former union ministers Tia Balu, A. Raja, Dayanidhi Maran, and the DMK Deputy General Secretary Kanimoli Karunanidhi. One notable omission of the list is that of Gautam Sigamani, who is the son of former minister Ponmudi. He has been dropped in Kallakurchi constituency. But Arun Nehru, the son of local administration minister K. Nehru, will enter the fray from Perambalur this time. Another heavyweight who has been fielded by the party is T.M. Selvaganapathi in Salem, which is the native of former chief minister and AIADMK leader Edappadi K Palaniswami. One surprising omission in the DMK's list has been that of S.S. Pallimanikam, the former Union Minister of State. He is a six-time MP from Tanjavur, but this time he has not been given a party ticket. So that's so far as the DMK is concerned. Now let's move on to the AIADMK, the principal opposition party in Tamil Nadu with the second largest vote share. Its leader Edappadi K Palaniswami had exited the NDA last year, hoping to cobble together a mega alliance. But unfortunately, much to the shock of the AIADMK and the surprise of its cadres, the party has failed to build a strong, credible alliance to take on the DMK-led India bloc. The AIADMK was negotiating hard with the Patali Makkal Kachi, but the PMK, which was holding parallel negotiations with the BJP, decided to join the NDA bandwagon in the last minute. The BJP has given it 10 parliamentary seats in its alliance. The AIADMK has now been forced to allot 5 seats to Vijayakant's DMDK, which is headed by his wife Premalata Vijayakant now after his demise. For the DMDK, as we all know, the vote share is very, very minor in Tamil Nadu. It's below 1%. So compared to its actual vote share, the number of seats, that's 5 that has been given to us, sounds disproportionate. So technically, the AIADMK will be carrying the DMDK on its shoulders. It has few other allies, most of them very small fringe political parties with which it needs to finalize the seat sharing talks. The AIADMK has also released a first list of candidates. One of them who's well known is Jayavardhan, the son of former Minister Jayakumar. But the party will face a big challenge in taking on the alliances of the DMK as well as the BJP. So essentially, Edappadi Palaniswami has a huge task to carry because the party cannot project any credible prime ministerial candidate and it has to take on two big formations. The BJP under its state president Annamalai has succeeded in cobbling together what you may call as a rainbow alliance. It now, as I mentioned, has the PMK, which has a significant influence in the one-year pockets in North Tamil Nadu and parts of Western Tamil Nadu, apart from one or two constituencies in the Delta region. The BJP is also taking along the Amma Makkal Munnetra Kalagam of TTV Thirakkaran, the Tamil Manila Congress of GK Vasan, and also O Panneerselvam, a former chief minister and expelled party leader from AIADMK. Technically, among these three, O Panneerselvam does not have any political party or symbol as on date. The Madras High Court has restrained him from using the name of AIADMK or its letterpad or flag in any manner. So technically, O Panneerselvam is heading a group that does not have a platform of its own. Now, how he manages the situation, whether he floats a new party, manages to get a new symbol, or takes the fight for the AIADMK symbol seriously, needs to be waited and watched. The BJP also has on its side the IJK, whose founder Parivendar is the sitting MP from Perambalur. Last time he had contested on the DMK ticket. Apart from that, they have the New Justice Party of AC Shanmugam. He is likely to be fielded in Velur constituency, and a few other parties, including that of John Pandian, who has some minor influence in certain southern districts. The Naam Tamilar Kaatchi, as I said earlier, has decided to stick to its decision to go it alone in this election as well. So if you compare this scene with 2019, it's way too different, because 2019 was essentially a battle between two big alliances, that of the DMK-led Secular Progressive Alliance, as it was called then, and the AIADMK-led NDA in Tamil Nadu, in which you had multiple parties. Apart from that, there was of course the Naam Tamilar Kaatchi and Kamala Hassan's Makkal Neethi Maiyam. This time, the Makkal Neethi Maiyam is not going to field candidates anywhere. Instead, Kamala Hassan will be campaigning across Tamil Nadu and Puducherry for the India bloc, and in return, he has been promised a Rajya Sabha seat. But however, one needs to take note that the Makkal Neethi Maiyam was seen as an alternative to these two Dravidian parties in the past. So now, whether there will be absolute vote transfer among its supporters to that of the DMK bloc is a big question mark, because many of them are also disillusioned that Kamal decided to join hands with the DMK. Also, one needs to note that another political party that was headed by actor Sharad Kumar, which was called the Agila India Samatva Makkal Kaatchi, has surprisingly merged with the BJP, and there are talks that Sharad Kumar's wife and popular actor Radhika Sharad Kumar could be fielded against Kanimoli Karnadadi in Thoothukudi district. We need to see if that happens, because while I'm speaking, the BJP list is not yet out. Now, I would say that this situation can be more or less compared to that of 2014. 2014 was a multi-cornered contest election where we had the DMK contesting almost alone, except for a few allies. The Congress went on its own. The left parties contested separately in a few constituencies. The AIADMK fielded candidates in all the 40 constituencies, including one in Puducherry. And the BJP had formed a very strong third front at that point. At that point, that front was led by the DMDK, because it had a very significant 10% vote share in Tamil Nadu back then. And the BJP and the PMK were equal partners in that alliance. That alliance also comprised the MDMK. It also had the IJK and the New Justice Party with it. The difference now is that the Congress, MDMK and the left parties are in the DMK alliance. The DMDK is with the AIADMK, but still I would say the BJP has put up an alliance that needs to be taken note of. In 2014, the third front, or the NDA at that point, managed to push the DMK to the third place in seven constituencies and the fourth place in one constituency, which was Kanyakumari. So this time we need to see whether the BJP managed to do a similar thing to the AIADMK, which is contesting almost alone with only a few allies to speak of. In terms of perception, yes, the BJP has made a big gain, I would say, by getting the PMK to join its alliance, because otherwise it looked like these parties would go with the AIADMK. So that way, Annamalai has managed to project a credible alliance that could take on the DMK as well as the AIADMK simultaneously. But if you speak practically, there are some issues here, because the regions where the PMK is strong, the BJP is not very influential. And the areas where the BJP is strong, say in parts of South Tamil Nadu and parts of Western Tamil Nadu, the PMK has very little presence there. So we do not know on what basis the vote transfer would take place in these areas. But irrespective of that, it will certainly help the BJP put up a strong show, improve its vote share, and if it manages to push the AIADMK to the third place in some constituencies, that will be seen as a huge gain, not just for BJP, but also for Annamalai's leadership in the National Party in Tamil Nadu. Some constituencies could see very close fights, notably Kanyakumari, where the national parties have traditionally held sway. So you have the Congress with significant influence there. The BJP also has a very strong presence, the DMK to some extent. So that is one constituency. Coimbatore is another key constituency that we watched very keenly, because that is one region where the BJP on its own itself has a very significant presence. The AIADMK is powerful there. For the DMK, the Western Front is a challenge, and that is why this time the DMK has decided to field its own candidates in many constituencies in Western region, while allotting most constituencies in South Tamil Nadu to its allies. Much will also depend on the kind of candidates who are going to be fielded. As of now, we know only some parties have released their candidates. So once all the parties field their candidates, we'll know the ground situation. We'll be able to discuss at a micro level or the kind of impact that the influential candidates will be able to play. At the moment, overall speaking, you know, the DMK alliance is set to garner the majority of the vote share. There's no doubt in it. By sheer arithmetic, they are ahead of the other formations. The AIADMK, I mean, as I mentioned, the Edappadi Palaniswami has to pull itself all the way. For the BJP, another minor irritant could be the issue of 10.5% internal reservation for the 1 year, which the PMK has been seeking. People like O. Panneerselvam have been against this reservation, because those belonging or his supporters who belong to the Mukkalathors have been opposing any sort of internal reservation for the 1 year. T.T. Vidyanakaran is also from the Mukkalathur community. So how these dynamics play out on the field needs to be seen. But the BJP, as I said, will look for improving its vote share, and it has certainly made a big headway by getting the other parties to ally with it and accept the BJP as the leader of the alliance. So we'll see how things fan out. I shall meet you in another video. Until then, this is D. Suresh Kumar signing off. Thank you.